My drill sergeant signed me up for jump school, and I didn't know it. I'd signed up for cook school. And come along, they was reading them off, and it said, jump school, Fort Benning, Georgia. And I was the third name they called off, and I tried to tell them they had made a mistake. And the drill sergeant was standing over there laughing. And he said, Bullock, you gonna make it.
And he says, you've got some college here. He said, you'd make a corpsman. And I said, what does a corpsman do? And he said, man, it's the best job in the Navy. He said, we send you this real great school, and then you'll work in a hospital, and it's like 9 to 5. You got your own room, and oh, it's a heck of a deal. Went through hospital corps school in San Diego, and walking into the hallway there, the first thing you saw in the old pink palace was pictures of corpsmen, Navy corpsmen, wearing Marine uniforms with Navy insignia. And that's when it impressed upon me where the Marine Corps got their medics from.
Fill this out for me.
What are you staring at? Do I have food in my teeth?
Oh, contraire. Your teeth, they're positively, sparkling. The teeth of a man half your age, if I may be so bold. you'll need one of these. Oh, my goodness. Don't we have strong hands? Well, enjoy!
Tippy, that was a very interesting approach to customer service.
Oh, dear. Was it, too much?
That depends. If you were trying to pick him up, I think it was about right.
Oh, good. Oh, no, I don't mean that I wanted to, no. hang on. I'm reading this book.
Body language and other subtle tricks to attract men.
The whole point being that if you don't send out signals that cry out, hello, I'm single and I don't want to be, well, how will anybody know?
Tippy, that guy's like 80.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I was practicing. I figured he was safe.
Oh, sort of like the dog chasing the car. What's he going to do with it, even if he catches it?
Well, I don't know. Oh, my goodness. That old adage about a man in uniform has never been more true. Oh, hello. How may I help you, General?
Captain, Stephen Doss, ma'am, and hopefully you can help me.
Oh, just a moment. I'll just get that. a moment.
Morning. Captain, was it?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir, U.S. Army.
Ah. Not by any chance looking for a deserter named of Cassidy, are you?
Well, I'll let her know.
No, sir.
Okay. Bye-bye.
At ease.
Thank you. There now. How may I help you, officer?
I'm looking for a Dr. Derek Hebert.
We have one.
Captain, nice to meet you.
Dr. Hebert. And thank you, miss.
Oh, just call me Tippy.
Tippy, nice name. We don't get many tippies in my line of work. Thank you. You've been very helpful.
My pleasure.
What can I do for you, Captain?
You filed a request for information about a Sergeant George O. Hebert, 104th Infantry, Timberwolf Division.
Yes, I did. He's my uncle, my father's brother. He was killed in World War II.
Well, we don't normally do this in person, but when your request crossed my desk, I took a personal interest. My grandfather fought with the 104th.
Oh. Gee, it's been months since I sent in the forms. I'd almost forgotten.
Dr. Hebert, I don't know if you're aware of it, but your uncle was a highly decorated soldier in World War II. He was a true American hero.
I had no idea.
What you have there are citations for the numerous medals he was awarded, along with a letter from his commanding officer documenting Sergeant Hebert's last days. You get the medals themselves in short order.
Well, this is pretty special.
Yes, it is, sir. It's not every day I get to meet the relative of a genuine war hero.
Just a little boy, I wandered through the woods. I didn't want to remember nobody's name. I just, if you're a doctor, if you're a nurse, do your thing and go on. Because if you become friends and know someone like that, it's harder to give them up than it is to not know them.
One thing about those days, though, everybody was proud to be, to have somebody in the service. It was an honor.
They say when you stare up in his face with that blank look on your face, you're actually having a mini seizure.
I'm not staring. I'm thinking.
Well, one man's thinking is another man staring.
It's a fine line, but I'm definitely thinking.
You got that look on your face, like you're about to give somebody some bad news?
Yeah. It's the part of this job that never gets any easier.
What can I do to help?
Nothing, I'm afraid. Unless you happen to know somebody that's got an extra liver laying around.
You talking about Gus Wanzik?
Yeah.
Well, you got your work cut out for you. He's not exactly the poster boy for organ donation. It's kind of a wonder he's made it this far.
He says he's dry now. I hadn't had a drop to drink for a couple years.
Still, it's kind of hard to get past the fact he ruined his own liver. I suspect he can't be too high on the list to get a new one.
No, he's not. Now I gotta go tell him he'll never live long enough to make it to the top of that list.
Day late and a dollar short, huh, Doc?
I'm not giving up yet.
Well, even if liver does come along, it makes more sense to give it to someone who'll make better use of it. Tell you the truth, I'm tired. My life ain't exactly been a day at the beach.
Did you know you have a piece of shrapnel in your back?
Shrapnel? What are you talking about?
I did an x-ray. There's definitely a piece of small shrapnel in your lower back.
Can't be. I was in Vietnam, but I was never wounded by shrapnel. At least I didn't think so.
Seems like something you'd remember.
Yeah. Well, I was a prisoner of war. Lots of things I don't remember. Don't want to. Vietnam. A war that keeps on giving. You ever know anyone who went to Nam, Doc?
Yeah. Peter Armstrong. He was my next door neighbor. He was also my hero. He was 19 and I was 8. He taught me how to play ball.
Yeah, well, I bet you he didn't come back the same man as when he went over.
He didn't come back at all.
That's the other side of the coin. Sometimes I wonder if they're not the lucky ones.
Gus, you got any family?
Sister, Margaret. Somewhere in Queens, last I heard. We ain't exactly been socially involved the last couple of decades.
There's this relatively new transplant procedure where you take part of one person's liver and transplant it into another person. Both livers regenerate and do fine, provided they're a match.
Margaret never do that for me.
Might be worth a shot.
Don't waste your time, Doc.
Okay. You're the boss. I'll check in with you later.
Hey, Doc. I got a number. Just don't know if it's any good anymore.
You're in the wrong station.
Well, I thought I'd see how the other half lives. Now, Janice, how come you haven't wised up and dumped this guy yet?
Honey, have I warned you? When you marry me, you'll be related to him. That's a high price to pay.
Ah, I can handle being a cousin-in-law. Now, Nick, is it true what Johnny tells me?
I doubt it. But you can run it past me and see.
He says that those who don't qualify to become firemen become policemen.
Yeah, well, that might be true. in Johnny's dreams.
Well, what are you guys doing here?
Don't tell me you forgot. We were gonna look at the car?
Oh,
man, we set that up 3 days ago.
Johnny, you didn't say you had anything.
Don't worry, I'm going with you.
I gave him a choice. Florist or caterer?
Food or flowers? You made the right choice. You guys go ahead. I know Rhonda would love to see you.
How's she been doing?
Well, this could be expected. But it's hard. For all of us. And for her. It's gonna take us a while to get past losing as many as we did.
Come on. We gotta get going.
Yeah. I don't wanna miss those Swedish meatballs.
Nah.
All right, hey, you guys do me a favor. Tell Rhonda I'll come by next week.
And
all right.
I thought Johnny was coming with you guys.
So did we.
Yeah, he and Janice had wedding stuff.
Oh. Beau is going to be very disappointed. We both miss him.
What do you mean, miss him? He's not here all the time? He used to practically live here.
You know, I saw him at his medal ceremony, and the last time he was at the house was for the funeral. I'm sure you saw the pictures.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Beau was very excited. He came running into me. Mom, look, Uncle Johnny's on the front page carrying a woman.
It's an amazing story.
Yeah, pretty much a miracle, if you ask me.
I'm sure if you asked the woman he saved, she'd say the same thing.
Yeah, story after story.
I think that Johnny feels guilty about Rob. I mean, the one day that he's late for work, the world changes. I think that being around us, you know, reminds him. I don't know. It's just that he doesn't seem to even want to give us a chance to talk about it.
How you doing?
All right. I mean, some days are better than others. Hey, Beau. Look who's here.
Hi.
Nate and Clint came to look at your dad's car.
Want to show us what you've done to it?
Nah.
Oh, he used to love that car just as much as Robbie did. He'd be out here helping him all the time, and then he'd come running into the house yelling, Mom, it's close to running. Now, he won't even go near it. I guess that's why I want to sell it too. This reminds us too much of Robbie. I'm sorry. I guess this is a day that's not as good a day as some of the others.
What did your uncle do in the war?
Infantry. He was a sergeant.
This stuff is amazing, Derek.
Wow, the Bronze Star, the Silver Star, the Purple Heart, you name it, he won it.
Can we see the medals?
Since I get them.
I can't believe your dad didn't tell you that your uncle was a war hero.
Well, you know, I'm not sure he even knew. When George died, well, war was actually over by the time we got word. It was very hard on my father. They were very close. Something we just never talked about. But this is going to mean a lot to him.
Listen to this. We regret to inform you that your brother was killed in the line of duty. Sergeant George O. Hebert was awarded the Silver Star for diverting enemy sniper fire away from the rest of his company and allowing them to safely reach their objective and carry out their mission. Sergeant Hebert was directly responsible for saving the lives of 14 of his fellow soldiers.
Wow.
That's also when he was killed. It was 3 weeks before the end of the war.
We had to do a report in school about an American who made a difference. And I was going to do it on Abraham Lincoln. But if it's all right with you, I'd rather do it on your Uncle George.
Well, I would say he was an American who made a difference.
He definitely made a difference to those 14 men he saved.
I think my uncle would be very honored, Raoul.
must owe you money. Never seen a doctor go all out for a patient like this.
I know it's been a while since you spoke with your brother.
You probably figured out by now that Gus and I didn't exactly come from an Ozzie and Harriet kind of family. Even so, I'd probably consider helping him. I guess you always want to believe that there's somebody out there that'll help you if you really need it. But unfortunately, I know that I am not the candidate. I'm a cancer survivor. It's been a year and a half, but I believe that knocks me out as a donor.
It does.
I wish I had a doctor like you. Maybe I ought to switch. What do you think? Oh. What if Gus had a son? Would that help?
It might, but Gus didn't say anything about having kids.
Well, I'm pretty sure he doesn't know. For that matter, I'm not really sure, but I heard my mother talking about it once. She didn't know I was listening.
You think I could talk to your mother?
Not unless you can commune with the dead.
Does anybody else know?
Yeah, the woman who had the baby. Her name was Julie Herrick.
How is it that Gus doesn't know?
He and Julie were inseparable the last year of high school. And just before Gus got drafted, he enlisted in the Marines. Just before we left for Vietnam, they were talking about getting married. And then about a month later, we get word that Gus had been killed in action. And then, like, less than a month after that, Julie up and gets married to somebody else. I mean, I thought it was awful quick. Then later we found out that she had a baby within the next year. I mean, it's possible that it's not Gus's, but it always seemed kind of fishy, you know what I mean?
Anybody ever ask her?
Not that I know of. Neither Ozzie or Harriet wanted to know. You know, I mean, they never liked him much to start with, and oh, they were drinking pretty good once they got word that Gus had been killed. He comes by it honestly.
But obviously Gus wasn't killed.
No. We found out about a year later that he was alive in a POW camp. By then Julie had made her bed, so to speak. And then it was, at least another year before Gus got back, only to find out that she was married with a 3-year-old kid. What Vietnam didn't do to him, I did.
Do you know anybody who could help me find Julie?
Honey, I'm home.
Hey.
What did I do?
You didn't do anything. In fact, I feel very fortunate to have you as my husband.
Okay. What did you do?
Janice called me today. Joni called off the wedding.
What?
Yeah.
I just saw them yesterday, and they were fine. They went to see the caterer.
Yeah, well, she's completely broken up. She said she didn't even see it coming. She's totally shocked.
Something's going on that we don't know about.
Yeah.
Raul wants to do his report on A Great American about Uncle George.
Well, that's very nice.
Did you have any idea Uncle George was such a hero?
Well, I guess the folks must have known, but we didn't say very much. I'm not surprised. He was the kind of guy who always put other people first. I remember when he wrote to say that he'd become a sergeant. Folks were very proud, but he downplayed it, said it was because nobody else wanted the job. It was just George. But we knew that they respected him, and we were very proud.
Mr. Abear, were you in the war, too?
No, I wasn't. I tried to enlist, but I had a bad leg, and they wouldn't take me. You know what I just remembered? I've got George's old Bible he used to write in, and like a journal. They said he was carrying it when he died. That might help you with your project.
Are you kidding? Of course it would. What do you say, Raul?
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, awesome. Hey, guys. This Bible of my uncle's is like reading a book you cannot put down.
Call me crazy, but I think that's what God intended.
My grandparents gave him this when he left for Germany, and he kept a daily journal in it. Listen to this. Finally, a break in the action. It seems almost too good to be true. A farm family took Bob and me in and made us fried egg sandwiches. It was incredible. Who would have thought that something that used to seem so insignificant could become so important? It certainly humbles a man, makes him appreciate his blessings.
Wow, that's beautiful.
Bob Haines is one of the men my uncle served with. Who knows, his might even have been one of the lives that George saved.
You know, some of those guys are probably still alive. Might be kind of cool to talk to them.
Okay. Okay, bye-bye. Okay. Well, batten down the hatches. Look who's here.
Batten down the hatches would be a naval term. I'm Army. We're the be-all-you-can-be people.
Oh, I love that slogan.
But do you live by it?
Oh, yeah, sure. Uh-huh.
That's good. I think it's important in life to go for the brass ring. Nothing ventured, nothing gained.
Oh, I love that phrase, too. What branch of the military is that one from?
That's my personal mantra. If I see something I want, I go after it.
You go, fly boy.
That would be Air Force. I'd like to continue this conversation sometime.
I'd love to be a fly on the wall for that one.
But right now, I'm on Uncle Sam's time. I've got something for Dr. Hebert.
Oh, he's in his office.
He's expecting me. Is it all right if I go back? I know the way.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Howdy, ma'am. Are you Julie Herrick?
It's my maiden name.
I'm Clint Cassidy. I'm a doctor.
Of what?
Excuse me?
You some kind of veterinarian or something? I don't have any animals.
No, I'm just a regular doctor. Kind of treats sick people.
I don't get many doctors knocking on my door, and if I did, I doubt they'd look like you. What do you want?
I think you may know a patient of mine, a fellow by the name of Gus Wanzig.
Well, I used to know Gus, but that was years ago. I haven't had contact with him in over 30 years.
He's a very sick man. I think you might be able to help him.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that. But I don't see what that has to do with me.
I've been told that perhaps you and he had a child together.
Did Gus tell you that?
No, Gus told me he didn't have any children. But if it were true that he did, that child might be the only chance to save Gus's life.
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, Doctor, but you must have the wrong information. Gus Wanzig is not the father of my son.
Corner of the screen, you see this, the second plane coming. And, you know, you watch the second plane live hit the second tower. And it was like nothing you'd ever seen. You know, you just haven't seen anything like it.
Myself and some of the firefighters that we've lost have always shared something. And that being that we've never been to war. We've never been in any sort of U.S. Army, infantry, marine unit. A lot of us felt as if this was our army.
Dr. Hebert, sir.
Oh, Captain Doss. To what do I owe the pleasure?
I felt I should deliver your uncle's medals in person. You should have had these a long time ago.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're welcome. I've also got information on that army buddy of your uncle's that you asked about. A Robert Bob Haines.
Really?
I took the liberty of tracking him down. This is where you can reach him.
You're good.
I discover on a daily basis either you're ahead of the game or you're out of the game. Which brings me to the young lady who works at the front desk.
That would be one Tippy Williams.
Yes. Interesting name.
Uh-huh.
What can you tell me about her?
Well, everybody loves her, staff and patients alike.
What about her domestic situation? Is she married? Any dependents?
No on both counts. I take it you're interested.
You're a perceptive man, Doctor.
So you think this lady is lying to you?
I saw something in her eyes when I asked her about Gus and her child. Mm. Yeah, I definitely think she lied.
It's always in the eyes, isn't it?
So, do you tell your patient that there may be a young man walking around who can save his life?
As a doctor, I have an obligation to do everything I can do to help my patients. But as a human being, there's other people's lives to consider.
Yeah, and it could blow up on you, and you could end up ruining, at a minimum, three people's lives.
Well, two. Gus's life's pretty much ruined already if he doesn't get a liver.
I think it'd get worse.
If Nancy's gonna die, I don't see it get much more ruined than that.
Well, I think it can. Even if Gus does have a son, what if he isn't willing to give up part of his liver to a man he's never met before, never even heard of?
She's right. It's not like we're asking if he'll let Gus borrow his blender.
We're talking about opening somebody up and taking out part of a vital organ. And what if the son says no? Gus is still gonna die, except now he knows he's missed out on sharing his son's life. And that same son has rejected a request to save his life.
You're right, that is worse. But taking that chance is the only hope that Gus has.
You're looking for Gus. You're already on the right floor.
Oh, I was actually here seeing someone else.
Really? What a coincidence. You just happen to be on the same floor of the same hospital where Gus is a patient. Definitely is a small world, isn't it?
Okay. I came to see him. I even got to the end of the hall. But I can't. I can't do it.
You come this far. It'd be a shame to let the opportunity pass by.
Gus and I have a history. I know you know that. Maybe some things should remain in the past.
Sometimes remembering the past can help us move ahead to the future. You know, visitors aren't exactly lining up outside his door. Seeing a familiar face, even one from the past, would be nice.
I mean, in some ways, I don't think it has anything to do with me.
What do you mean?
Well, I know he loves me, but after everything he went through in the World Trade Center, he puts up a good front. But I know he's carrying it around with him. And I wanted to help him work through it. And I hoped us getting married would help him do that. Let him know that there's a future, something to hope for. He's pushing everyone away who's ever meant anything to him in his past.
Hey, Gus. You got a visitor. You feel up to it?
Well, I don't have any old friends, and it's a little too late in the game to make new ones, so whoever it is, you just... tell him.
August. How are you?
Julie. I ran into her out in the hall. She was on her way up to see you.
Why? After all these years.
I just felt like I needed to see you.
I know the feeling. It's the same way I felt about you when I was rotting in a POW camp in Vietnam.
Gus, they told me that you were dead.
Yeah. And how inconsiderate of me not to be. Well, you certainly got on with the rest of your life pretty quick, didn't you? Well, you're in luck. Looks like I'm really gonna die this time.
I told you this was a bad idea. I'm sorry, guys.
A lot of emotion flying around that room in there for two people who haven't seen each other in almost 30 years. He's the father of your son, isn't he?
Gus and I planned to be married as soon as he got back from Vietnam. I was so happy. And then... a day I'll never forget as long as I live. We got word that he'd been killed. I had lost the love of my life. I didn't see any reason for me to live. I wanted to die, but I was pregnant. I hadn't told anyone, not even Gus. I didn't know what to do. But then I realized that baby was the only part of Gus that I still had, and I had to go on, if only for that.
Why'd you marry someone else?
Thomas Matthews and I had been friends for years. He let me share my grief with him. I had no job, no way of making a living. A single girl about to have a baby. They were very different times then. So when Thomas offered to take care of us, I said, yes. And we agreed to raise the child as our own. Then, when we got word that Gus was alive, I didn't know what to do. Everything had changed, and when he came home, he wouldn't see me. He was drinking all the time. It was as though he was a completely different person. Thomas was the only father that Jeremy had ever known, and they loved each other. So, as time went on, it just got easier and easier to play the charade.
Where's Thomas now?
We were divorced 10 years ago. Jeremy was really the only thing keeping us together, and when he left home, there didn't seem to be any reason to pretend anymore for Thomas or me.
When you walked into that room, I saw something in Gus I'd never seen before. For the first time ever, I saw a spark of life in his eyes.
I've never loved anyone like I loved Gus. But my priority has to be my son and the man who helped me raise him. What do I say to them?
I understand, Julie. But I got a patient in there who's gonna die. The only person out there who can save him is your and Gus's son, who's of legal age. And I have no choice but to tell him and hope that he'll help. I prefer it came from you.
Strange to be 19 years old and meet someone that grew up 40 miles from your home, 13,000 miles away from home. And that's how Thurman and I met. We met in Vietnam. He's the only person that I ever heard of that missed their airplane to go home.
The day I was supposed to come home, Donnie was out in the bush. He was on another patrol with his team.
We weren't on the ground an hour till we found out that we were being followed. And it turned into a running gunfight, us trying to find a place to big enough to get a helicopter into to get us out.
They'd made heavy contact. And what came over me, I don't know. I've always told Donnie that it was that $5 he owed me.
And they took us back, and when we landed in the field next to the landing zone, somebody grabbed me and pulled my radio off and grabbed my rifle, and I looked, and it was Doc. And I said, what are you doing here? You're supposed to go home. But, you know, as we walked up the hill, I got to thinking about it, and had it been the other way, I couldn't have left either. Not if my friend was in fire. I'd have had to stay to see what was going to be the outcome. And he didn't leave me. He was there.
Bombs away! Bullseye, direct hit!
Me too, no survivors!
Unfortunately for you, there is one survivor, and she says, that's it, war's over.
Don't you hate it when they bring in the heavy artillery?
Time to do your homework.
We're doing it. This is research for my school project.
Nice try, boys. Justin, isn't that your mom out here calling you?
I don't think so. If you hear anything, it's probably just her yelling at my dad.
Enemy
Chief, you take one side, I'll take the other.
Hi, guys.
Don't shoot, he's one of ours.
Raul, wait till you see this. Hello, everybody.
Hey, Dr. D. What are you doing behind enemy lines?
Got my uncle's medals. Also, I got some information on Bob Haynes, the guy my Uncle George wrote about in his journal. And yes, he is still alive. That's a silver star.
Whoa, war is so cool.
No, war's not cool. My Uncle George had to die to get that.
You mean he never got to wear it?
He never even knew he won it.
That really stinks.
Now you're getting it. Raul, it's a free school project. You know, Bob, you saw and did a lot of stuff with my Uncle George. I was reading some of what he wrote in his journal.
You mean that Bible he carried with him?
Yeah.
You mean you have that?
I do.
Oh, you know, he was always either reading or writing in that Bible. Mm.
You still like fried egg sandwiches?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, they never tasted so good as they did that day.
I bet.
Oh, man. Funny how things get blurred through the years. I remember those little moments just like they happened this morning. We were just kids. And suddenly one morning we woke up in a foreign place, just trying to stay alive.
I can't imagine what it's like to be in the thick of battle for the first time.
Well, I remember thinking there was no way you could prepare yourself for being shot at. And less chance of you preparing yourself to shoot at somebody else. Yeah, they were just like us, scared kids. But you couldn't think about that. War won't let you think about that.
Were you with my uncle when he died?
Yeah. We were pinned down by enemy snipers, and they were knocking us off right and left. And we all knew we had to do something soon or we'd be wiped out. That's when George started advancing toward the snipers. But he drew such intense fire that their positions were revealed to us, and we could shoot back. And it worked. Just as George knew it would. He saved my life. That day. And a whole lot of other lives. But he paid for it with his own. You know, not a day goes by that I don't say a prayer. Thanking God for George Hebert.
I want you to meet my father.
Oh, I'd like that. I think the others would too. There's only five of us left, and I think they would like to meet Sarge's brother as much as I would.
That would be fabulous.
Hi, there's someone here to see you.
I'm Dr. Cassidy. So you're the one who decided to turn my life upside down. I'm Jeremy Matthews. Apparently you know my mother. My father.
You're Julie Herrick's son. Sorry for the circumstances, but I was really hoping you'd come in.
So I don't need this part of my life?
No. But you do need to know this is major surgery. I'm sorry, he's my patient. I couldn't let any stone go unturned.
That's me, the stone, an object, a donor.
If there'd been any other way, I would have chosen it. But there wasn't. I admire your mom for telling you the truth.
Yeah. Well, family secrets.
Put simply, your father, my patient, he'll die unless you help. If you're not a match, he'll die anyway.
Unless he's got some other kids out there someplace nobody knows about. Have you told your patient about me?
No. If you decide to be a donor, provided you're a match, then he'll need to know. But if you're not a match, or you decide not to be a donor, there's no need to tell him.
How do we find out if I'm a match?
Why would I want to go to a reunion with a bunch of old Army guys?
Well, Dad, these aren't any old Army guys.
Well, I appreciate the gesture, but no thanks.
Well, I thought it would be nice to pay tribute to Uncle George and the men that he served with.
Yeah, kind of a busy time right now. I don't think so.
Dad, these are the guys that were with Uncle George the last year and a half of his life.
Derek, thank you, but the answer is no.
Yo, Johnny. What, you don't answer your phone anymore?
Sorry, been kind of busy.
Or is it you know what I want to talk about, and you don't?
Could be it.
Cuz, look, it's your life. But from where I sit, you calling off the wedding has less to do with Janice, more to do with what you went through at Ground Zero.
You're right, it does. But not in the way you think. Look, when you go through something like that, it changes you. It makes you look at things differently, clarifies your vision. And ultimately what I saw was me and Janice wanted different things.
I know you, Johnny. You love this woman.
I do. I love enough not to make her put her dreams on hold for me. And I learned enough about myself in these past couple months to know I can't put my dreams on hold either.
Now, hold up. Look. That's a nice speech. But that's all it is. It's not the truth.
Yeah, it is. Just because it's not what you or Beverly or Janice want to hear doesn't mean it's not the truth.
I'm a cop, remember? I got paid to know when someone's telling me the truth.
Hey, don't pull this on me.
Look, you and I have been fighting a war on the streets long before those planes hit the towers, man. I know what it can do to you.
Don't go there, all right? Don't try none of that psycho babble garbage on me.
Look, Johnny, just talk to me. I know what it's like. I know what it's...
No, you don't. You have no idea what it's like or what I'm going through. You don't like what I'm doing, you don't gotta watch.
Why would I want to go to a reunion with a bunch of old Army guys?
Well, Dad, these aren't any old Army guys.
Well, I appreciate the gesture, but no thanks.
Well, I thought it would be nice to pay tribute to Uncle George and the men that he served with.
Yeah, kind of a busy time right now. I don't think so.
Dad, these are the guys that were with Uncle George the last year and a half of his life.
Derek, thank you, but the answer is no.
Shot in the left hip, the left leg, and my teeth blown out. And these are plastic government issue. Most 53-year-old men don't have a nice looking set of teeth like I do. Mine's even got my name in them.
Over the years, I volunteered 3 times, and they always turned me down because I had a bad leg. And
I told them that I was good enough to stay with the best of their walkers, and I guess they wouldn't believe me anyway.
And our job was to get to the top of this pile, which maybe was 7 stories high at the time, to get up there, to get hose lines up there, and to get guys up there to search the pile for any surface victims that might be trapped so we can rescue them. And we did, later on that night, we did get a Port Authority cop out.
One thing about those days, though, everybody was proud to be, to have somebody in the service. It was an honor.
Did he say why he wouldn't go?
No. Just got annoyed and walked away.
You mean he's never spoke with any of the men that served with his brother?
I don't think so. And he should. Uncle George is a hero to those guys. I saw that with Bob Haynes.
Maybe it all strikes just a little too close to home.
Maybe you're right. My dad's kind of old school. We've never been a family that shows much emotion. I mean, we care about each other. We just don't talk about it. We don't say, I love you and stuff like that. I've never seen my father cry.
Wow, my dad's just the opposite. The older he gets, the more sentimental he gets. Other night, I made him a spaghetti dinner. He teared up.
Could have been your cooking.
My dad is someone who never asks for help. He's always the strong one, always there for everybody else. I thought this was finally a chance to do something for him. Seen those guys that do him a lot of good.
Well, in my experience, sometimes you just gotta force the issue. Our parents ignored us when we complained that we didn't like carrots and we didn't want to take piano lessons, am I right? Because it was their job to know better. And now it's our job to know better.
I didn't know you played piano.
I know. My parents didn't force me, but I wish that they had. Exactly what I'm talking about. However, I do like carrots.
You're right. I just gotta make this happen.
Westbury Clinic. Speaking. Oh, hello, Captain Doss. Well, that's very kind of you to say. You have a very pleasant telephoned voice, too. Yes, I drink coffee. Oh, yeah, sure, that would be good. 1600 hours it is, then. Okay. Okay, bye-bye. Was that what it sounded like? We're going for coffee.
Yes.
Yeah, 1600 hours. What time would that be exactly?
This is the best homework assignment that anybody ever had.
Yeah.
In my class, I had this report on great poets. Yeah, right. I doubt they give medals to poets.
They probably live longer than soldiers.
Yeah, but I'm not really a poet kind of kid. I think I'd make a better soldier.
Yeah. You think you'd want to be in the war?
Before I knew that you got killed, I did.
Yeah. It'd be kind of neat to see some parts, but some parts wouldn't be that good.
Yeah.
Too bad Derek's uncle had to die. He could have sat around and told us about it. Then we'd know without having to go.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I guess he could get killed being a poet, too.
Like how?
Like you're walking along, thinking of some words that rhyme, and you walk on the street, and without looking, a bus hits you.
Yeah. You know, no job can be totally safe.
Nope.
Johnny's one of the good ones. But I'll have to tell you.
Yeah. When we were kids, we had it all planned. I was gonna be police chief, he was gonna be fire chief.
Doesn't surprise me. I saw him save that woman that day, you know. He runs back in, building's collapsing all around him, pulls her out. Not 30 seconds after he got her free of the debris, the whole building totally collapsed. He would have been crushed, too. It's amazing why some people live, some die. Who knows?
You think I'm worrying about him for nothing?
I wish I could say yeah, but I think he's one messed up fireman. You know, he's not alone. We all need help getting through this. He's not taking the help, you know? What he is taking is chances.
Like what?
Last week, runs into this chemical plant without his Scott air pack. Says he thinks there's somebody in there. There's not, but it doesn't make any difference. If he keeps doing stuff like that, he's gonna die too.
I can't get through to him. I don't have any credibility. I wasn't there. I thought maybe you could talk to him.
Tried. He doesn't listen. He acts like he does, but he doesn't. We'll listen to Rob. I think that's why he can't forgive himself. He's here, Rob's not. If Rob can't be with his wife and kid, he figures, what right do I got to get married?
Oh, Dr. Cassidy just came in.
Thanks. If you agree, I'd like to do the surgery as soon as possible.
I'd like to meet him.
Amongst ourselves, the POWs, but just to average people on the street and things like that, we just don't talk to them about it. We got a memory that we don't share with everybody.
One's name was Funk, and the other one's name was Thomas. Sad for them, but they wandered into a booby trap, you know, and it took both those boys out. Their names are on the wall. Panel W-26. Every time I get to D.C., I go by and pay my respects. That brought it home to me just how quick you can be here and how quick you can be gone.
Every day you get a little stronger, but it's a thing that you'll never forget. I mean, we get stronger here in the firehouse because we have to, and we have to continue. We have to continue saving lives and protecting the property of the citizens of New York, and that's our job. But deep inside, we still have that hurt, and that hurt will never go away, never.
Been married 28 years now, and she saw me through a whole lot of bad nights, you know, coming, because it was, I didn't go to the wall. It took me 20 years to get to the wall. I didn't talk about Vietnam or anything else for 12 years, and I finally was able, by the grace of God, to deal with it.
I've never been in a war, but I hope to God my son doesn't have to see anything like this.
Hey, Derek.
Ah!
I got an Am I Hero project.
That's great.
Yeah, he wanted to come down and show it to you.
Hey, Anson, what you got there?
Oh, this is Raoul's An American Hero Made a Difference project about Michael George.
I was talking to him.
Oh!
My class said I had the best hero.
Really?
Oh, this is terrific.
That's not all of it.
Yeah, check it out.
Raoul, that is fantastic.
Yes, it is. And I know just who should see it.
Tippi, you and I have a lot in common.
Well, we both like coffee.
I felt a connection since the first time we laid eyes on each other. You must have noticed it, too.
I didn't think I was being that obvious, but there is something about a man in uniform.
I think we'd make a good team.
You do?
Yes. And I'm ready to make a commitment, if you are.
My goodness, you military guys sure don't beat around the bush.
Like I said before, if I see something I want, I go after it. What do you say?
Hey, how was your date?
Well, it wasn't exactly a date. It was more like a... Oh, gosh, what's the word?
Casual get-together?
Job interview. Yeah, turns out he needs a new assistant, and he was captivated by my office proficiency. Oh, and he liked my phone voice.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, we were having this whole conversation, and it turns out that he was talking about this one thing, and I thought he was talking about this whole other thing. We were on two completely different planets.
I'm sorry, Tippi.
Sorry. Oh, no, no, don't be. It actually ended up quite nicely. When I told him that I really like my job here, he said, well then, since we aren't going to be working together, I don't have to worry about any rules against dating the help. And then he asked me out.
You gonna go out with him?
Well, I told him I'd think about it. You can't be too anxious, you know.
What's going on?
We found a donor.
You gonna give me a piece of your liver?
If I could. If I was a match. I would. I've thought of you so many times. I wanted to talk to you. I wanted to tell you.
Tell me what?
About your son. Jeremy is your son.
He's the donor. He wants to meet you.
Get out of here. Get out of here, both of you! Get out, both of you!
Gus.
I don't want no transplant.
Gus, you're gonna hurt yourself.
I don't want any help from you. I'll die before I let you help me.
Gus.
Get up!
I need you to come with me now.
Get out of here!
Calm down.
I don't want any help from her. I don't want it.
It's gonna be all right.
Just take a deep breath, buddy.
I guess I was kind of lucky being from Nashville, Tennessee. It wasn't as bad as a lot of my friends had talked about it was when they went home. California was awful. I mean, I got egged at the airport trying to come home on leave. That's one of the bad things about the Korean veterans and the Vietnam veterans is there weren't any yellow ribbons around any trees, and there wasn't anybody there to pat you on the back to tell you thanks for a good job. I get more thank yous for a good job today than I ever did when I was 21 years old.
I had a Bronze Star catch up with me after I'd been home. And if somebody had told me that earlier in my life, I would have thought, boy, I want the news cameras, I want mama, I want daddy, I want the girlfriends that snubbed me, I want everybody to see this. I never told anybody. I wasn't ashamed of it, but it was kind of thing, I think, in retrospect, the way I handled it was that if I told somebody that I was getting a medal or that I'd been to Nam or that whatever, they'd probably say something stupid because they didn't understand. It wasn't that they were trying to be malicious. It wasn't because they were anti-this or anti- they just didn't know any better.
God saved me for some reason. I kiss the ground when I come back.
How do you have closure? You want to say goodbye to your friends, and the fire department is something that's based on a lot of tradition and a lot of ceremony. And if you're brought up with ceremony and tradition, how do you say goodbye to somebody without having any remains?
And in the back of it, my mother wrote me a note. Please carry this in your pocket. The Lord has power to bring you back home. My mother prayed for me. And I appreciate everybody who did. I thank you. And I thank America for my freedom. and I'm ready to step back up if I'm needed. I'll do that.
I don't believe I've ever had a patient take a swing at me before.
I'm glad to be the first.
Gus, you may think this isn't any of my business.
Now you're getting it, Doc.
But I'm taking the position that this falls under the broad umbrella of total patient care.
It doesn't.
Then let me bring it into something more specific. There's a person out there who can save your life, if you'll let him.
What life?
I can't even begin to pretend that I understand what you're going through. But I do understand something about losing the people closest to me. And I know that you can never get over the hurt until you first let go of the hate and the anger. It's been eating you up for a long time, Gus. Now's your chance to let it go.
She was the only thing that kept me alive when I was over there in that camp. They kept me in a concrete box. The only human contact I had was when they came to torture me. I'd go days, weeks without hearing another voice. But I always heard her voice. Her sweet voice. Saying, please come home. You gotta get through this. I'm waiting for you. I can't live without you. When I came back and found out she'd gone on with her life, I was so sorry I didn't die in that box. At least there, I could believe she cared.
She told me she never loved anyone else in her life the way she loved you. She thought you were dead, Gus. Caring for your son was the only thing that kept her going. She believed that through him, part of you still lived. Now that son can give all of you a second chance. That's a gift. Don't turn your back on that. He wants to see you. Any son.
Okay, so you're probably wondering what I want to talk to you both about.
I gotta admit, I am curious. I know it can't be about my homework. I got it all done.
Yeah, and I did all my chores, so...
Cut it out. This isn't a joke.
I'm sorry, Ro. What's on your mind?
You know, I've been working on that project about Derek's uncle.
You did a great job on it.
And it made me think about some things.
What kind of things?
About, you know, war and stuff. So here's the thing. I want both of you to promise me something. If there's a war, I'd understand that you have to go fight. But don't go at the same time. I don't want to lose either of you. But I really don't want to lose both of you.
You got our promise on that.
Come here, little man.
I was gonna ask if you wanted to grab a bite to eat, but I didn't know it was your night for guard duty.
Actually, I have a date with Captain Dog.
Oh, so you've gone from playing hard to get to hard to see. Oh, that's a camouflage joke. Yeah, that's cute.
Yeah, that's me, always trying for cute.
Yeah, I decided that it was best if I didn't press my luck on that hard-to-get thing. And you know those military men, once they get something in their heads, they are relentless. Do you think that it's a bit too much?
Not if you're going to dig a trench or track a sniper.
Oh, dear. Well, I hadn't planned on either of those things. I just wanted to, you know, show him that I was interested in a subtle, yet obvious, kind of way.
Yeah, I got a wacky feeling he's gonna love it.
Well, he's picking me up at 1800 hours, and oh, it is 1755, so I'm just gonna powder my nose.
Evening, Nurse Nickel.
Captain Doss, you're 4 minutes early.
Always leave myself a little cushion. Sometimes you need it, sometimes you don't.
And you're in civvies.
Yes. I like to let my hair down a bit when I'm off duty.
Don't we all? Captain, brings you back to Westbury. Nothing medical, I hope.
No, sir. Strictly a personal visit.
Guess he's 4 minutes early.
Give me a hint. Is he an officer and a gentleman?
Tippy, you look absolutely military.
Wow. The words every woman longs to hear.
Thanks. You look pretty spiffy, too, Captain.
Oh, thank you. And please, call me Stephen.
Oh, of course. Steve.
Stephen,
do you think it's possible to change back into that army outfit?
That would be my army uniform.
Right. Yeah, there's something about that uniform thing.
That same thought crossed my mind. What's your pleasure, dress greens or khakis?
You mean I have a choice? Well, I'll just have to think about that. Oh, thank you.
Quite a couple, aren't they?
See why you say you and Janice want different things. She wants you to stay alive. By all indications, you don't.
You ever think your greatest wish would be that things could just be normal? You know how when something terrible happens to people, they ask, why me? I keep asking, why not me? I was not with the guys on my shift in that tower when it fell. And you know what the answer is? I overslept. I was late. Rob wasn't supposed to be there. I was supposed to relieve him. He was coming off his shift and I was going on. He was in my place.
You really think Rob stayed because you were late? You can't believe that. He stayed because he was Robbie, man. Because there was an emergency, a need. Same reason all those other guys who were off shift went to hell. Just like you would have. I don't think that lady you saved would say you were late. I got a feeling she'd say your timing was perfect. Nothing you do can bring Rob back. And all you do by losing your life now, or cutting off those you love, just make him suffer twice. He's already lost one father. He can't lose you too.
Gone.
give. It's something you have to earn, you have to respect it, and you have to maintain it.
And I made a little talk about freedom and patriotism. Through the eyes of POW. And it kind of gives a person the insight of what freedom is, and it's freedom is not free.
George's brother, Roy, was also working for him. And they brought a telegram that he was missing.
This one day, the depot agent come up with a telegram that George was missing in action. Not very good. Just then 1 week later, to the hour, to the minute almost, he walked in again with another telegram saying that he was killed.
A very sad time.
Only brothers. We were also friends.
This is Raoul's school project. He got an A. They said he had the best hero. This is a letter from George's commanding officer. He says some amazing things. You should read it.
Well, that's very nice, very nice. You tell Raoul I would give him an A, too.
Dad. Why don't you ever want to talk about any of this stuff?
What do you mean, want to talk about it? It's a nice book.
Yeah, a book you don't want to read.
Well, I've seen most of it before, anyway.
Well, you haven't seen this before. This is the Bronze Star. That cluster means he won more than one of them. The Purple Heart. This one's the Silver Star. That to him posthumously for saving the lives of 14 men on the day that he died. Dad, I want you to come with me and meet some of those men that served with Uncle George. And I am not going to take no for an answer, not without talking about it at least. Dad, I know we've never had the kind of relationship where we discuss this kind of stuff, but it's not too late to start. If it still hurts that much, maybe it's time to let it out.
I knew about the medals, Dad. I knew about the men he saved. I knew. And every time I thought of them, I resented them because they were still alive. The best man I ever knew wasn't. My brother was a hero to me long before anyone had ever heard of the Timber Wolf Company. He didn't need to die for me to know that. I was the one the telegram came to. George must have put me down as the one to notify, so the family wouldn't have to hear it from strangers. Actually, there were two telegrams. First one said he was missing in action. And then exactly 1 week later, to the minute, I got the second. We regret to inform you that on April 18, 1945, Sergeant George Orlando Hebert was killed in action in the service of his country. hardest thing I ever had to do in my life was to tell my parents. The son was dead.
It's okay, Dad.
Yeah.
It's okay. I love you, Dad.
I love you too, son. I love you too.
Dear Doc, in the dictionary, it defines hero as a person distinguished for exceptional courage, fortitude, or bravery. A nice definition. But I once asked someone I considered to be a hero how he'd define it, and he said a hero is simply someone who does what needs to be done, even when they wish there was some other way to do it. I like to think that's how I'd respond, but we never really know until we're faced with the circumstances. I guess that's what makes heroes so special. Unfortunately, people nowadays tend to confuse heroes with celebrities. Anybody who's famous seems to be given a certain status without us ever asking why they're famous. As if people knowing who we are is some kind of accomplishment. As a great historian once said, celebrities are people who make the news. Heroes are people who make a difference.
There are no words to describe how the people in this room feel about your brother. The guys who fought with him, our wives, our children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. None of us would be here if it wasn't for him. In his honor, whenever we meet, we always set a chair for Sarge. Nobody sat in that chair for 56 years. Tonight, we'd be honored if you would.
If we just know how to look past all the famous people, we'll see there are plenty of heroes still around. And even if they don't always look like we might expect them to, that doesn't change what they did. And God, please help us if we ever forget those who fought for this country and what they sacrificed. Let their memory always remind us that freedom ain't free.
I knew a man, called him Sandy Cain. Few folks even knew his name. Left a boy, came back a man. Still many just don't understand about the reasons we are free. I can't forget the look in his eyes or the tears he cried as he said these words to me. All gave some gave all, some stood through for the red, white, and blue, and some had to ball. And if you ever think of me, think of all your liberties and recall. Some gave all. Santa Cain is no longer here, but his words are oh so clear. They echo throughout our land. For all his friends who gave us all, who stood the ground and took the fall, to help their fellow man. Love your country and live with pride. Don't forget those who died. America, can't you see? All gave some. Some gave all. Some stood through for the red, white, and blue, and some had to fall. If you ever think of me, think of all your liberties and recall. Some gave all. If you ever think of me, think of all your liberties and recall. Some gave all. Some.